So I also enjoy the fact that students, there's no big barrier between students and professors, right? They can just come, knock on your door, ask a question, chit-chat about life, about their curriculum, about their future research, or whatnot. Hey there, I'm Alex Gezerlis. I'm a professor here in the Department of Physics at the University of Guelph. Before coming to Guelph, I was a fellow at Darmstadt, Germany. Before that, I was a postdoc in Seattle, Washington. Before that, I was finishing up my PhD in Los Alamos, New Mexico, which I started at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. And before all that, I studied at the National Technical University of Athens, Greece, where I'm from. I've been at the University of Guelph for roughly 8 years now, since 2013. So a number of things drew me to Guelph, the most notable being the very strong nuclear physics effort, which was experimental at the time, but had now grown to also involve theory. But more broadly, when I interviewed the people, right, both grad students, faculty, postdocs, everybody were incredibly welcoming and friendly. So it was just a very, very pleasant place to be in. So the fundamental questions that my research program tries to address are, for example, how does matter come to be and how does it evolve? Other questions are, how can we go from the very, very small to the very large, from the microcosm to the macrocosm? So my research focuses on nuclear theory, broadly construed. That includes a whole bunch of things. So that includes nuclear forces, that means two or three neutrons or protons interacting with each other. It also includes nuclear structure, which is how to build up nuclei composed of 10, 20, 100 particles, starting from those nuclear forces I mentioned before. It also includes nuclear astrophysics, which in our group's case means neutron star structure. Neutron stars are these exotic objects which are very dense. They have a lot of mass, more than our sun, but they're tiny. They're like a radius of 10, 15 kilometers. And in addition to nuclear theory, I also work on cold atom physics to the degree that ultra-cold atoms can teach us something about nuclear physics. So the very, very big picture of the research is, could we start from the smallest scales known to mankind, meaning quarks and gluons, so the theory of quantum chromodynamics, build up to nucleons, neutrons and protons, and from there build all the way up to nuclei, stars, and so on. What got me into physics in one word is astronomy. So when I was, I don't know, 14, 15 years old, I picked up my brother's astronomy textbook and I just worked through it over one summer. And I was, and still am, intrigued by, you know, the stars out there and how that relates to life here on Earth. In a way, what I am doing now is still related to that original, you know, starting point, because one of my research areas is neutron star physics, which is nuclear astrophysics, and astro is a Greek word for star. So what I really enjoy about physics in Guelph is the collegiality. That's something basically every physics department says about themselves, but here it's true. So I actually enjoy the fact that colleagues are friendly with each other, students just knock on your door. I work with many graduate students, many talented graduate students, and many talented undergraduate students also. I have a fairly large group for a theorist, so I routinely have 5 to 6 graduate students and 1 or 2 undergraduates at any given point in time that are working with me. So the practical day-to-day aspects of a student in the groups in nuclear theory involve a lot of programming, whether on a desktop, like simple programming, or on a supercomputer, a cluster, and so on. They also involve analytic work, so equations, plotting, and so on. It's one of my first projects with graduate students here at Guelph involved doing computation, heavy computation, like, you know, a lot of CPU hours on a problem for neutron stars. A few years later, I came back to that problem and worked with another graduate student on the same problem using a simpler approach. And what was really, really rewarding was, a few years after that, those two projects kind of came together. So a very powerful but somewhat limited technique was combined with a, you know, simpler technique that has a broader reach. And the answer on something that is known as the compressibility sum rule, and it's okay if you don't know what that is, the answer turned out to be spot on, exactly what anyone could have hoped for. Crucially, we did not know this ahead of time, and you know, that's how research goes.
My research work varies quite a bit, right? So let's say in nuclear theory, there's two large schools. One is you do phenomenology, you try to come up with a way of describing experimental data, even if the connection with fundamental theory is not fully there. And on the other side, you have ab initio, first principles theory, where you make a minimum of approximations, and the approximations that you do make are controlled. Now, in our group, we do both, right? So when you come across a fork in the road, take it, right? I don't see a reason to choose. For very, very, very difficult problems where you cannot do first principles calculations, you can do something simpler that teaches you about the universe. For easier, but still not easy problems, one can do first principles studies. So nuclear physics involves a whole bunch of things, right? It involves applications, it involves energy, medical isotopes. That being said, the work we do in my group, so in nuclear theory, as we define it and as we apply it, is curiosity-driven science, right? It's basic science, learning what we're made of and how that works.